Good morning, Bunker Hill Baptist Church and friends. Thank you again for tuning in to our worship service. And many of you are beginning to wonder, or have been wondering for a long time, when we're going to be able to open up for our regular worship services. And hopefully we'll find that out here just shortly, because our church council is going to be meeting today at 5 o'clock to discuss the how and the when, and how we can do this effectively, open up and safely. And what I'd ask of you is that you would be praying that our council would make the right decisions on how we could go about getting our worship services back started. And I feel pretty sure that within the next week or so we will be open, but we'll find more out, and you will get that information as soon as we get through with our council and have our meeting. Also, remember that the baby bottles are still available. We've had a good response so far, but we still got about another case of bottles left. And if you haven't had an opportunity to get one and put some change in, or dollar bills, whatever, let us know, and we'll get you a bottle, or either drop by the church and pick one up for yourself. Also, we'll be having a deacons meeting in the fellowship hall. That'll be on the 7th of June. That'll be on a Sunday, and that'll be at 8:30, and so there'll be plenty of space out. So deacons, we will be meeting on June the 7th, so make sure you mark that down on your calendars. And then we're going to have something a little bit different we had never done before because of this COVID-19 virus. We're going to have a drive-through baby shower. It'll be the first time we've ever done that. We'll be honoring baby Summer Wilkes and the parents Tyler and Amber Wilkes. That'll be from 2 o'clock to 3:30. You'll be able to just drive around. We'll have a place where you can just drop your gift off and wave at them and let them know that you're thinking about them. But be sure to mark that down. That's on June the 7th between 2 and 3:30. And now on our prayer list, talk to Fred Herring. He is sounding a little stronger, still going through his treatments, and still he'll be having a test done Tuesday and then going back Wednesday to get the results from the doctor. So continue to pray for him. Pray for a good report that he will get. Miss Marguerite Spikes, talked to her last night, and she was just really talkative and feeling a lot better, hoping maybe within the next week or two she'll get to go home for a few days. And then if the fluid in the hip shows to be negative as far as having any more strep, then they'll be setting up a hip replacement surgery. So pray that she'll continue to get good reports on that. She did want me to express to the church her deep gratitude for all of the cards and calls and letters and prayers that's been offered up for her, and she just appreciates that very much. Also, I want to remember Kenny Carson, John Bates, Birdry Donaway, Melissa Martin, Tony Reed, and Dom Kucha. He has been coming to our church off and on for quite a while, and he's also being diagnosed with some cancer, so I want to be in prayer for him. For many of you who may not be aware of it, Brother Jim Ray had a stroke earlier this week, and he's passed away. So be in prayer for Brother Jim's family. And I think that is all the prayer requests that I have at this moment. So let us go to our Lord in prayer. Gracious Father, we bow in your presence this beautiful morning that we have, and Lord, such gorgeous days that you've given us, and we thank you for that. Lord, we thank you for your care for us during this time of pandemic, and Lord, that we're looking forward to an opportunity, Father, to be back together here together in worship. And so, Lord, we pray your blessings upon our efforts as we want to get back together as a body of Christ to worship you together cooperatively. But Father, we do pray, Lord, right now for these who are on our prayer list, these who have many needs. Lord, there's many who are going through treatments for cancer, many who are looking for surgeries, and Lord, others who are in the hospital recovering from past injuries. So Father, we lift up all of them up to you right now, asking Father that you, in your divine will, Lord, will lay your healing hand upon them, and Father, that they would praise you and thank you for the results. Father, we do pray for all of those who have special needs in our congregation this morning, and all of those friends who may be listening. Father, I thank you that we can bear our burdens to you, and Lord, knowing that you already know what's best for us. So Lord, we give ourselves over to you in this prayer time, and Father, look into our hearts, see those things that are concerning us, and Father, I pray that you would take those and replace it with peace, knowing, Father, you know how to give good gifts to your children. Lord, I just ask you to bless this time we have together as we look at your word, Father, today. May you be glorified. I pray that the body of Christ would be strengthened, and Father, my prayer, if someone is lost today, they'd come to know Jesus. For I pray this in his precious name. Amen. Well, this morning, as I want to bring this message to you, I have a question. Have you ever had something that's ever gotten your attention? You know, my dad, whenever I was a young boy, he had a special way of getting my attention when I messed up. You know what that was? It was called a belt. He had my undivided attention. You know, I began to think about it. What grabs your attention? What really grabs your attention? If you're just out in normal mouth, what about a whistle? When you hear a whistle go off, it just sort of perk your ears up. Or the sound of a siren when you hear it blast. Or you're sitting out on the front porch and all of a sudden a flashing clap of thunder hits real close by has got your attention. You know, did you know that God Almighty is an expert, a very expert at getting our attention also, or at least trying to get our attention? He has many different ways that he does that, how he tries to grab our attention. I love some of the ways in the Bible that it talked about. He used a burning bush to get Abraham's attention, walking along, herding his sheep, and all of a sudden he sees the bush burning. But it wasn't being consumed. It caught his attention. I think about Balaam and the talking donkey. I mean, if you run across a donkey, and I'm not talking about Mr. Ed on TV, but it's for those of you old enough to know, but if you heard a donkey talking to you, wouldn't it have your undivided attention? And then Jonah. A great whale swallowed him. It had his attention. He began to cry out to the Lord. You know, so when I began to look at those things, and some of these are very, very simple ways of getting your attention. In the morning when I get up and I look at that beautiful sunrise, the creation, all of the flowers in bloom, and I think about that, I say, God, you're just amazing. He has my attention. Sometimes he gets our attention in other ways. Sometimes natural disasters that occur. Boy, we've had our share of those here lately. And sometimes it's tragedies or sickness and even death can get our attention. You see, God uses all things, to grab the attention of his children and even those who aren't his children yet. Why does he do that? Why does God do things he grabs our attention? Why does he do it? You ever thought about that? I believe many times it's because you and I may become distracted by the things of this world. We're caught up in chasing the things of this world. We have a lot of self-interest. How is it going to benefit me? And that's a lot of times what we look at and what we want. And we begin to take our eyes off of God, off of the one that we're totally dependent on for everything. Sometimes we think we're the masters of our own ship. We think we're the ones who are in control. And so God has a way of getting our attention to remind us that we're not in control. We're not independent. We are dependent upon God himself. So he uses many things to get our attention so we won't ever forget that he is God. He's the one who sets the rules for us to live by if we're going to live under his blessings. You know, so I wanted us to look this morning at Amos. Amos is a good book. It's just like reading the newspaper today. It could fit us in every category that they want to look at today. But I want us to look at Amos in the fourth chapter. I'll be looking at several verses, but my main topic verse will be, "Therefore, thus will I do to you, O Israel, because I will do this to you, prepare to meet your God, O Israel." That is verse 12 of chapter 4. Father, we thank you for your word. And Lord, as we read from your word, how you have always used different techniques and different things to draw our attention back to you, I pray, Father, this message will cause us to really focus upon you and to hear those words that you give to Israel. Prepare to meet your God. Lord, may we take this to heart today. And if there's any changes in our lives that we should make, Father, I pray today is a day that we would make them. For it's in Christ's name that I pray. Amen. That is the context, really, of what Amos is about. You know, the people had drifted away from God. They began to worship other gods, worship the things of the world, and they had pretty much didn't think they needed God anymore, and they sort of got away. And so God was gently but steadily trying to get their attention through things that happened in their life. Matter of fact, if you looked at verse 6 in chapter 4, you would find out that God tried to get their attention by food shortages. You know, it said the cleanliness of teeth and lack of bread. In other words, there was a shortage of food going around. Now, we've never really had a lot of shortages of food around, but just the other day, walking down the aisle at Walmart, and I began to look at this aisle where I wanted some bread at, there wasn't none right then. Not at least the kind that I want. There was a shortage of it. You know, but can you imagine that they didn't have anything? There was a shortage of food during that period of time. Well, in verses 7 and 8, it tells us that God used droughts. In some cities, rain in other cities, floods in other parts, but still they didn't have enough water for everybody to enjoy. But even that didn't cause them to return to God. It says it right here in his word so plainly. You know, in verse 9, it said God allowed crop failure, the plagues of locusts. And even that, he said, didn't cause you to return back to me. He's trying to get their attention. A lot of people just think things happen. That's just the way it is. But we need to really be aware, is God trying to tell us something through everything that we go through in life? I believe he is. I believe he's trying to tell us we need to get back to him. We need to be following what his dictates. In verse 10 of that same chapter 4, even war and death didn't get their attention. And God said, yet they still did not return to me, says the Lord. He sent the same plagues in the same manner that he sent to Egypt. And they just took it in stride and they didn't think anything about it. He even showed them about Sodom and Gomorrah and how he destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah with fire and earthquakes. And they had experienced fire and earthquakes in their time. And it still didn't stop them from living evil ways. All attempts is what I'm trying to say that God, our gracious God, our merciful God, was trying to do for them to draw their attention, they ignored. Don't matter, we'll get by. We're going to make it. They rejected everything that happened. It could be a possibility that God may be trying to tell me something, show me something that he wanted to do. But with everything that God tries to show and tell us, there is a time when his patience will run short. You know, God's patience, his long suffering, and here in Amos, it had reached its limits. I mean, it had totally reached the limits of where he was going to go. And they were going to see another side of God. It wasn't one of mercy and just love. It was one of wrath. We need to forget that God, while he loves everybody and he is a God of love, a God of mercy, and a God of grace, we sometimes forget that he is also the God of wrath. And he was trying to get them low. Because the people had refused to turn back to him, he issued this command. Prepare to meet your God. Now, that was not something that you arbitrarily just, well, I can do that or not do it. He said to do it. He said, prepare to meet you. You know, I love what they say in Romans chapter 10, verse 31. He says, it's a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. John Wesley preached a wonderful sermon on that. Maybe one day I'll borrow some of that and preach on it. But Think about whose hands you'd be falling into. Prepare to meet your God. Is that warning just for Israel? Absolutely not. It's not just for Israel. That's why it should get our attention today, because it's a powerful command of God. It's relevant to our generation today more so than I've ever seen it in our world. For our world itself and our nation as a whole is going so far away from God, and He's done things after things after things after things to try to get our attention to turn us back. People need to get prepared to meet God. I believe that with all my heart. Because we're going to meet Him. Sooner or later, you can count on it, you're going to meet Him. And that's why it's so important that we study God's Word. We learn from what happened to God's people when they turned away, or when people turned away from God and didn't need God. You know, we need to pay attention to the warnings. Why? Because God doesn't give you any empty warnings. When God says something, He means it. That's why we can trust Him with everything in our lives. You know, it's a warning that nobody should ignore, but unfortunately, there's a lot of people in our world today that ignore the warnings of God. A lot of people don't even want to hear about it. All they want preachers to do is to preach the love and the grace of God and never tell the consequences of not accepting that in their life. Oh yeah, it may be uncomfortable. It makes me uncomfortable as a Christian to know that one day I'm going to stand in front of my Savior Jesus Christ, just like every believer will. You know, Paul gave us this warning also. He said that everyone one day would stand before God. In chapter 14, verses 11 through 12, he says, "It is written, as surely as I live, says the Lord, every knee will bow before me, and every tongue will confess. So then each of us will give an account of himself to God." Every one of us. This ought to get every believer's attention. I don't care who you are, how long you've been saved. It ought to be able to get your attention. Because one day we will stand before the Lord Jesus Christ. We won't be at the great white throne judgment. We'll be at the Bema seat. We'll be at a special place for the believers that will stand there. And each one of our works, everything that we've ever done, will become evident, will be brought into light, those good and bad things that we've done. You see, it's the fire of God's righteousness, Paul wrote, that will test the quality of each one's work. You can find that in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 13, if you want to look there and find it. But everything that you and I do as a believer is going to be tested. It's going to be, whether good or bad, it's going to be there. This is not a meeting for condemnation. That's already been covered under the blood of Jesus Christ at the cross. A lot of people think that that's what he's talking about, but it's not. For now there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, who walk according to the Spirit and not according to the flesh, according to Romans 8:1. What this is, though, is a time when you and I will give an account for our careless words, our actions, our non-actions, whatever they may be. We will give an account of that. But also every good thing that we've ever done for the glory of God also will be taken note of. We will receive rewards and have rewards taken away from us. This has nothing to do with our salvation. We will give an account. And as I was preparing this, I began to ask my own self some questions, and I hope maybe you'll question yourself about it this morning. Am I really prepared to meet Jesus face to face one day? To really give an account of how my life has been lived for Him since I belong to Him? Is your life what it ought to be? Has it really what? Are you going to stand before Jesus one day and ask yourself, could I have done better? Why didn't I do better? Those are the things that will be humiliating for me to stand in front of a man who gave his entire life so he could set me free, that I didn't have any bondages of sin in my life, and yet I didn't do a whole lot while I was here on earth for him and for his kingdom. You see, all believers will one day stand before Jesus who died for us, no exception. And what a day that will be. I can't wait to see Jesus face to face, to be able to thank him for what he did for me. And I'm sure many of you feel that same way. I don't know how I will act, how I will respond. I don't know what will happen when I see Jesus that first time. You know, that great song, I Can Only Imagine, keeps running through my mind. What will I do? Will I laugh? Will I shout? Will I dance? I don't know. I think I want to hug and kiss his feet. I don't know exactly what I do, but I know one thing. It's going to be an amazing thing to see the man who loved us so much that he gave his life that you and I could have eternal life and be in the presence of Almighty God. Have you surrendered your life to the Lordship of Jesus Christ? Have you done that really? Are there things that you're still holding back? You see, for the believer, we won't have that great white throne judgment, praise God. But I want you to know, there's going to be another judgment that should get a lot of people's attention. There's going to be those who are going to meet God at a place called the Great White Throne Judgment. That is the worst place in the world that a person can find themselves in. In Revelation chapter 20, nobody really likes to hear it. Verses 11 through 15 tells you what you can expect when you meet God at that Great White Throne Judgment. Everyone who has died, everyone who will die without receiving the Lord Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior, are going to be present at that throne. It's a great white throne of judgment. It's a powerful throne. There will be no escaping it. There's no way you can go from it. Let me just read to you and then I'll give you something. He said, "Then I saw a great white throne and him who sat upon it, from whose face the earth and the heavens fled away." It tried to escape. "And there was found no place for them." There was no escaping this place, is what he's saying. "And I saw the dead, the small," what he's talking about, the common, the just a regular everyday person, "and the great," those who thought they were something, those who were noble birth, those who were had it all. And where were they at? They were standing before God. "And books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged according to their works, by the things which were written in the books. The sea gave up the dead who were in it. Death and Hades delivered up the dead who were in them." Understand, there's already people there in this place called hell, in this place of Hades, of torment. It's going to give them back up one day for the final judgment. "And they were judged, each one according to his works. Then death and Hades were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And anyone not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire." Now, I don't know about you. I don't know how anybody wants to be in that judgment, how anybody wants to be there. But everybody who's rejected Jesus or failed to receive Jesus, had the opportunity to receive Jesus, there will be no escaping this judgment. You can't hide, as I said earlier. This will be a place where there is no pardon, where there is no mercy, and the books will be open. And it will have all of the recorded deeds of all people. Every one of them. I'm sure that they will be rewarded every opportunity that a person had to serve God, to accept Jesus, It will have every excuse that they ever made for not coming to Christ. There'll be no defense. And worse than all, there'll be no advocate. Jesus won't be standing there to be your advocate. He will be your judge. And they were judged, each one, according to what they had done in life. And anyone not found written in the book of life were cast in the lake of fire, forever damned, forever doomed to suffer. Make no mistake on what I'm saying this morning. If your name is not written in the Lamb's book of life, and the only way it can be there is by knowing that you have received the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, you accepted what He did for you upon the cross, and in faith have repented of your sins and turned to Him. If you haven't done that on the authority of God's word, I tell you today, you're not prepared to meet God. You're not prepared. You're not prepared to meet Him face to face, because that's going to be a horrible day. A day of judgment. It's one of mankind's most important appointments, because it's inescapable. Try as you might. The question I would ask you, if you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior this morning, is your name recorded in the Lamb's Book of Life? And the answer, if you've never done it, no. If you have done it, I believe with all my heart that wherever your name is listed in that Lamb's Book of Life, your name is probably written in red. That song, written in red, is one of the most beautiful things that you will ever hear. That means everything has been wiped away by the blood of Jesus Christ. You're forgiven. And if you've never received Jesus by faith, I want to tell you, it's a horrible final judgment that God describes is coming for you. You see, a lot of people are counting on, well, I've been a member at Bunker Hill Baptist Church for years and years and years. My name been on the roll. A lot of people. That ain't gonna matter. It won't matter if you've been baptized 3 or 4 times. All that matters is your name written in that Lamb's Book of Life? And there's only one way that can be done. And that's through faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. We need to be prepared to meet Him. Today, that's taken so lightly. And even Christians today get offended when preachers stand up and talk about what's coming, what's coming. My job as a pastor is to follow what God's word says and to inform His people and all who would listen that there is a day coming. It always won't be like you're living today. One day you will stand in the presence of Almighty God and give account. But many today pay no attention to that. Oh, He's just trying to scare me. I'm scared enough for both of us that there may be somebody within the sound of my voice that lets this get away from them and they don't pay any attention to it. And one day the end comes. And I believe on that day, one day, they'll stand and they'll remember in God's presence every opportunity they had, every time they listened to a message and they refused to follow what God's word said. They'll understand that they should have given it their full, undivided attention. Just suppose today, believer and non-believer alike, that you died today and you found yourself in the presence of Almighty God. All the things of this life that we deem so important won't be important anymore. Won't mean a thing. Because life on this earth is over with. That chapter is closed. Eternal life begins a new chapter that will never end anymore. You see, there'll be things we need to think about. God showed us so many things in His Word. Remember the rich farmer? You remember all that he had, how God had blessed him so immensely in life? I mean, he had a bumper crop, and he wanted to build bigger barns so he could store more goods, so he could have more stuff for himself. Never once mentioning God, never thanking God for anything that he ever had. And God called him a fool. He said, "Today, your very life's going to be demanded of you." All of that wouldn't matter anymore. You see, he had made no preparations. He'd made a lot of preparations to live in this world, but he'd never made any preparations to live in the world to come. Today, a lot of people are well educated. They got the best degrees you can have. A lot of them got great jobs with good pay and good retirement. They live in a great life. But they have made no preparation for the life to come. That's foolish, because life itself teaches us that one day this life will be over, and there will be a new life beginning somewhere. My question is, are you prepared to meet Jesus? Christian, are you prepared to meet him at the Bema seat and go over all of the things, what has been done in your life or what you've done, whether good or bad? I don't want to have to do that. I'd rather just confess that right now and get it under the blood and start afresh and anew. You see, that's what God has made it so easy for all of us who are believers. If we confess our sins, He's faithful and just to forgive us of all unrighteousness. You know, that's my paraphrase version. You look at John chapter 1, verse 9, and find out. I don't care if you've been in church, like I said, all your life. It doesn't mean you're prepared to meet Jesus, to meet God. Just because you've taught Sunday school or discipleship training or you sang in the choir or you've been a preacher, a deacon, a good moral person, that doesn't mean anything if you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. You're not prepared to meet God. Israel wasn't prepared to meet God. They didn't have a proper relationship with God. They didn't care about a relationship with God like so many do today. Remember, I told you earlier in this message, they had famine, food shortage. They had all kind of things that had happened to them. Wars and death and even going into captivity. All of this wasn't an accident. God was trying to get their attention to turn them back. Could God be doing that to us today? Could He be allowing things happen in our nation, in our own individual lives, just so that we would turn back to Him and depend upon Him for everything that we need? Is it possible that God's trying to get our attention? I think it's really possible. I really do. We have gone so far away from God today doing our own thing that pretty much a lot of people don't think they need God. He's allowed calamity after calamity to come upon us. Some sickness, some catastrophe is always on the horizon to happen. And what's the sad thing about it is a lot of people just think that's the way things are. You know, life just has a cycle. Things come, we do good and we do bad. But never considering that there is a possibility that God may want to get your attention, may want to draw you close to Him, to have a relationship with Him. Israel was about to meet God, and they were going to have a serious encounter, and they were not prepared, but they were warned. The same is true for us today. We still have God's Word. It's still as relevant today to us as it was to the people who in the Old Testament time, in the New Testament time. Praise God, you can be prepared to meet God by turning in faith and repentance to Jesus Christ, knowing that God wishes that no one should perish, but all come to the everlasting life that comes through Jesus Christ our Lord. He paid our sin debt. Are we living in such a way that we say thank you to Jesus whenever we stand in his presence? Have you trusted him? If you haven't, you need to today, because we don't know when tomorrow will be the last day. Maybe today's our last day. Do you know the peace that comes with knowing that you're ready to meet Jesus Christ? One day, you and I as Christians are going to give an account as well. Let us live our life in such a way that it be pleasing to the Lord Jesus Christ, that when we do stand in his presence, we can hear him say, "Well done, my good and faithful servant. Enter into my rest." For those of you who've never received Lord Jesus Christ, please do so today. Bow your head, ask Jesus to come into your heart. Failure to do that and to leave this world will lead God to tell you, "Depart from me, for I never knew you," into that lake of fire. That's not what God wants for your life. Neither is what I want for yours. I want you to know the joy that comes through a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. When he tries to get your attention, pay attention. It's for your good. Father, I thank you for your word. Lord, I know that in life there are many times that, Father, we just think things happen. But Father, you never do allow things to go on in our lives without a purpose and a plan. And Father, this message today is as relevant to us as it was in Amos's day. Father, we need to be prepared at all times to meet you. And the way that we can do that is through that relationship through your Son, Jesus Christ. Father, thank you for the gift of eternal life that belongs to all who would receive Jesus. Father, may everyone today make sure that they are prepared to meet Jesus on that day when he calls us home. And I pray this in the precious name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.